And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1 p.m. Stay tuned next for your own health and fitness.
Welcome to Your Own Health and Fitness. I'm Lena Berman. Jeff Fawcett and I come to you weekly with a critical, independent voice on the politics and practice of health and the environment.
I learned a new phrase preparing for this show, settler colonialist. It was used to refer to people buying up land in a water-poor region of the Great Plains and invoking the sanctity of private property to take what they regard as theirs in spite of the established local governance of water as a commons. This story is as awful as you think it is. The settler colonialist spirit made America great the first time, and we're getting it back again. But what I thought of is a picture I have of my aged great-great-grandfather and his family. They're in a field, no doubt on the family farm, back in the Midwest. He is seated. Everyone else is standing, including my great-great-grandmother. They were settlers, a label I'm sure they wore proudly, a label our culture celebrates. They probably would not have been troubled at being called colonialists, which is celebrated more selectively, pilgrims, original colonies, and so on. I mention this not to bring your attention to the injustice of settling land that was already inhabited, nor the injustice of a land ethic that justified and continues to justify the settling and the colonizing. What I want to draw your attention to is that the path of settler colonialism has led to Monsanto, monocrops, soil erosion, soil depletion, agribusiness, confined animal food lot operations, CAFOs, immiseration of farm workers, degradation of food, and other miracles of modern agriculture. What I want to bring to your attention is that land injustice is intimately entwined with the toxic food ecology we inhabit and much, much more. My guest today is Justine Williams, Ph.D. She is co-editor of the collection Land Justice, Reimagining Land, Food, and the Commons in the United States, published by Food First. She is also managing director of the CUBA platform, which focuses on the social dynamics of agroecology and permaculture in Cuba. Justine Williams, welcome to Your Own Health and Fitness.
Thank you so much for having me with you, Jeffrey.
As I framed this interview, land seems to have a dual nature. It's a thing of utility. It gets used for something, for all sorts of things. And it's also a thing of inherent value. It's a commodity that can also produce commodities, so it can be capital. At the same time, it's where we live. So am I correct in reading your collection of essays that those two aspects are inseparable, and that changing how land is of value from the perspective of justice is intimately and fundamentally bound to how it's used?
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Jeffrey. And I think what this brings us to is an interesting question today about the relationship between the value of land in terms of use and the value of land in terms of the way it's been distorted in our marketplace. So what we see today in many cases is that because of all the demands we put on land, commercial development that comes along with urban sprawl, the use for energy extraction and production, we're at a point where the value assigned to land is often much higher in numbers than a farmer can produce just out of the use. And so part of the question of land justice is figuring out how to get past that and to bring these values back into sync so that people wishing to use land for food production and for food justice are able to actually afford the land.
Now, your work in the Cuba platform is in this same realm. How has that work informed the works that are in your book or the works that you collected, the work you did in putting together that book?
Well, so before I came to working on this book and working in collaboration with Food First, which is a food think tank based in Oakland, I was living in Cuba. I was living in a central Cuban province called Santi Spiritus, and I was working on research with farmers there, as you mentioned, farmers doing agroecology and farmers doing permaculture practices. And I had a chance to really see what it can look like in a society when land is valued very differently. And so now in Cuba, land, there's some private property, but most land allocation decisions are made by the state. And so a lot of the farmland that farmers are working is under their management at the discretion of the government. And what this means is that any person who's interested in farming, who's interested in producing food for their communities, is able to petition the state for that land and get it essentially at no cost. And this just totally changes the whole equation about farming. It makes sustainable production practices such as agroecology and the production of healthy food so much more viable because farmers aren't having to compete with other land uses. And so after I worked on this book of essays, Land Justice, I moved on to working on this project called the Cuba Platform, which is actually not focused on agroecology and permaculture, but equity issues in general and how different countries can sort of collaborate with Cuba to expand new ideas of equity. And we think that this land question is absolutely essential to it.
I have further questions about that a little bit along, but what I wanted to talk about first is kind of this notion of the social dynamics that determine how land gets used. And in the United States, those dynamics are principally driven by the sale of commodities produced off the land or extracted from the land, and the accumulation of capital. So it's commodity production and accumulation of capital. And the first two sections of the book talk about two populations that are struggling against that stream. One's African-American communities, particularly in the Gullah Geechee communities off of South Carolina, North Carolina.
South Carolina, Georgia.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and the other population is women farmers. So you raise here are two groups that just as populations have social justice issues of their own, and these essays talk about how that affects them as farmers. So how does each of those struggles illustrate the development of alternative futures for land use and agricultural production?
Sure. So that's wonderful that you've started out this question by pointing our attention to the question of commodity production in the U.S. And there's a great preface in the book that was written by George Naylor, who's from the National Family Farm Coalition,
mm-hmm.
Who traces this history of commodity production. And I think a lot of people in the U.S. who are critical of the way we've come to mono-produce soy and corn tend to think that this is the fault of the money that the federal government gives for these kinds of commodity crops. And in fact, what George Naylor is pointing out is that most farmers who are producing tons of corn and soy are struggling financially themselves. And they're kind of strung into this system of continually accumulating more land and growing more soy and corn, whether or not anyone needs that soy and corn really for dietary purposes. And a solution to this could be introducing an idea of agricultural parity, which is something that we used to have here in the U.S., which is setting stable prices for crops. So if farmers know how much they could get every year from corn and soy, then we might be able to rein in some of this overproduction. And there would also be no need for farms to become so huge. And so this leads really well into the question of what's happened for historically Black farming communities in the South who have lost a lot of their land along this process of scaling up farms. So during the years when it became increasingly necessary for farmers to scale up and overproduce, a lot of farmers, not just in the South, but across the country, were really struggling to get fair access to resources from the USDA and from federal government institutions. So while farmers in the Midwest and across the country were taking out loans in order to buy up more farmland, a lot of farmers of color, particularly Black farmers in the South, were being denied access to loans like this. And so they were, in many cases, losing their land because it was no longer economically sustainable to farm just a small plot. And they were kind of roped out of buying larger tracts of land. So we see this process really just being sedimented where it's really to no one's benefit. And what's particularly tragic about that is that in the 60s and 70s, there was this vibrant Black land ownership set of movements happening in the South that were really using land as a basis for social justice work, and had successfully bought up many large tracts of land, only to eventually be pressured, often by local government, off of that land, and sometimes lose it because they couldn't get any kind of loans from local governments. But fortunately, a lot of those movements, even though they've been reduced, are still thriving in the U.S. today through groups like the Federation of Southern Cooperatives, who are continuing to encourage ways of collective land ownership and cooperative land ownership to make it economically feasible for farmers and farmers of color to produce food for their communities. And the question of women is distinct but very interesting and important as well. I think a story from the book that's really interesting is what's happened with land ownership in some Midwestern states, including in Iowa. We have a chapter by a sociologist named Angie Carter. And she points out that, interestingly enough, even though for many generations women were prohibited from inheriting farmland in the U.S., and that was only possible for men, today, actually, more than 50% of landowners are actually women. So we see that policy changes have helped to provoke a little more parity in terms of ownership in land. But unfortunately, culture has not always caught up and social currents have not always caught up. So in Iowa, for instance, even though many women are land owners, they have not been culturally brought into the world of farming. They have not grown up being trained to be farmers. They have been encouraged not to farm their own land and to rent it out to others. And there now are a number of them who are starting to resist this trend and who are coming together and form groups and cooperatives to support each other. And although I don't want to make any kind of gender essentialist claims that women are more likely or less likely than men to encourage more sustainable and healthy forms of farming. But in this case, many of these women are more interested in sustainable farming techniques than is the norm in their communities. And so they're starting to make big changes by coming back to the land that they haven't been using and trying to bring sustainable methods.
I'm going to have to ID the show. You're listening to Your Own Health and Fitness. I'm Jeffrey Fawcett. I'm talking today with Justine Williams about her book, Land Justice, Reimagining Land, Food, and the Commons in the United States. So what you just described and what is in the book is at once heartbreaking and not surprising, but also in terms of how to move forward, a complex picture. I'm kind of back to this theme of how people have access to land has a lot to do with what the results are, what's the commodities, what's the food ecology that's being produced here. And you just remarked how there is kind of this separation among the women farmers between actual ownership of the land and use of the land, and a lot of it's simply rented out to the mode of production as it exists. There's a much more complex discussion in the sections on what's called black agrarianism, about how as you noted, that much of the agrarianism was very much involved in social justice movements throughout the 20th century. So what I'd like to hear you talk some about is what are the barriers that these kinds of groups that are specifically affected by social injustice, how are these groups, or what are the barriers to these groups moving to a better form of agriculture?
Sure. And so when you say a better form of agriculture, are you imagining how barriers to them making impacts on the system moving towards other kinds of farming?
Well, the production of monocrops is something that has kind of crept up. A lot of the literature that I read is most of those farmers would actually, they'd like to grow, do real farming. In fact, right. one of the things I was going to note that maybe this segues into it is that in another section, there's another group that's discussed and the barriers to them, which is young farmers who really are dedicated to call it a new land ethic, want to really do farming. And there are lots of systematic barriers to them being able to do that, having to do with land tenure and so on. So there's a population of people who seem to be motivated to do agriculture right in some sense, and they're simply not able to get to it. And it's not just that they can't get to it, but that, for instance, the kinds of investments that they need to make, the physical investments in the land for permaculture, for example, are extensive. You have to put a lot of work into it. And if they're renting land that and the lease expires, they've just wasted they don't have an actual investment in the land. And so there's this systematic barrier to doing agriculture the way it ought to be done. So what I'm toying with here is, how do the essays, how does the book tell us, illustrate for us, show us a path from where we are now to some better future of agriculture? And what are the barriers, which are numerous? It would take an hour just to go through all the barriers, but how do we overcome those barriers to get to a better way of producing food?
Sure. Well, and so to touch on some of those barriers and get those out of the way before moving on to the more optimistic side of the question, I would just emphasize that land access, pure and simple, really is the biggest barrier that we're hearing being faced by farmers, both young farmers and people who perhaps are not so young but would like to begin farming. It's been this really rather amazing accomplishment of the food movement, the food justice and food sovereignty movements over the past decade or so that we finally have reached a point where we have a number of young people or people who aren't yet farmers who would like to be and who recognize how central food production is and our society and our politics and our culture. But the vast majority of them have absolutely no resources when it comes to land and no clear path for financing either. And then if you want to talk about the question of how can they think even beyond farming at all towards farming in ways that are more sustainable, more ecologically beneficial, using agroecology or any kinds of organic techniques, that kind of farming is particularly expensive and involves a lot of labor and most of these farmers who would like to enter into doing farming a better way, as you said, are very conscious of how many problems we have in our labor system on farms as well, and they don't want to replicate this process of poorly paying farm workers. And so they're kind of stuck in this process of a farming pursuit that's not very lucrative to begin with and really doesn't generate enough profits to help people move from renting to owning farmland. And in terms of a pathway forward, I think it's going to have to be very multi-pronged. You know, when we talk about land justice, sometimes people sort of roll their eyes and say, you know, well, land reform certainly not going to ever happen in this country. I mean, when you think about land reform, you think about other countries like Cuba, where I've worked, and other parts of Latin America, where there really has been a national-led effort to take back and to redistribute land. And I think there are some people involved in the land justice work in the United States who would like to imagine that that would be possible in the United States and who think that in many ways that would be the just and fair and equitable thing to do, considering our country's history of land appropriation. But short of that more radical and comprehensive path, there are a lot of steps that people are taking today to sort of gradually push us towards a better future. And so I'll touch on a couple of them. There are certain efforts to get land back into the system, back at the disposal of farmers. For instance, there are a lot of people talking about reparations. How do we put economic capital and land capital back in the hands of Black farmers and farmers of color? So one of the authors of one of the essays in the book, Leah Penniman, she has a farm called Soulfire Farm.
Yeah.
And she is part of a network called the Northeast Farmers of Color Network, who are doing a really cool project of creating a map that links farmers of color who are in need of resources, who are attempting to access land, to people who have overabundance of these and who might wish to give this land and these resources back. The National Black Food and Justice Alliance is another organization that's national and is involved in some work like this on a countrywide scale. And so these are really exciting projects. They are, you might consider them in some ways in the same kind of category of similar projects going on with land banking. So there are some urban areas around the country, including Philadelphia, that are experimenting with land banking. So if there's unused land in cities, how can it be publicly administered in a way that helps get it into the hands of people who would like to use it and produce good food on it? And unfortunately, there is a drawback to the way these projects are possible right now, which is that they rely to a certain extent on philanthropy and on the motivations of people to do what's right in terms of giving land and resources back. And so they can get us to a certain point, but of course, with the amount of land that is just concentrated and in certain hands and in the hands of very private interests and very wealthy interests, they're not very likely to be doing any giving away of land anytime soon unless policy pushes them to do so. And so I think it's really important to think seriously about structural reforms that could lead to policy change as well. And there are a variety of ways to think about doing this. In urban areas, and of course, food production in urban areas is incredibly important considering the concentration of people in urban centers. And there are interesting ways to think about how cities could create new laws around unused or underused land that could disencourage people who are buying up land just as speculators from letting it sit idle, or who could force that land back into public hands or the hands of people who are specifically interested in urban farming. At a rural level, which is, of course, where most farmland is, things are a bit more complicated. There are laws on the books in several states that I think are important to explore more broadly, that prevent corporate ownership and accumulation of farmland, and that is absolutely essential. I mean, farmland doesn't have to be owned by a corporation for it to be a sort of problematic example of accumulation, but preventing that from happening is really essential. And I think that's a step that states can take. And then there's a lot of work that could be done at the federal level, although there is just a massive amount of resistance. And I think many of our allies in the land justice movement are very fed up with doing this kind of work. But there is work that could be done to make sure that in the Farm Bill and in federal policies that there's a fair amount of money going towards young farmers, going towards Black farmers, going towards Latino farmers and Indigenous farmers, so that they are able to build up and expand their operations. And then to pass that work on to other people. A lot of these people are doing training work. So if they're able to secure, you know, solid economic footing on their farms, then they're able to help pass that on to others in their communities as well.
I am going to have to take a brief musical break. When I come back, I'll continue talking with Justine Williams about her book, Land Justice, Reimagining Land, Food, and the Commons in the United States. Stay tuned. You're in the right place. Thank you. Welcome back. This is Your Own Health and Fitness. I'm Jeffrey Fawcett. I'm talking today with Justine Williams about her book, Land Justice, Reimagining Land, Food, and the Commons in the United States. Our website, yourownhealthandfitness.org, has more information about this show, as well as our almost 700 other shows. A free download of today's show, free open access to recordings of all our shows, a free newsletter about upcoming shows, and more. To contact us, email us at admin@yourownhealthandfitness.org. Justine, how can listeners learn more about your work?
Well, I would encourage them to check out the website of Food First, that is foodfirst.org, and to search around on there for the page about land justice. And from there, there's information they can access about the different authors who are involved in this book, and I would encourage readers to do what they can to check out each one of them, because this book is not just a project of Food First and of myself and my co-editor, Eric Holt Jimenez, but is a project of a number of really inspiring community organizations around the country. A couple that would be particularly wonderful for people to learn more about are the Black Belt Justice Center and the Land Loss Prevention Project, which are doing a lot about protection of Black-owned land in the United States.
And I wholeheartedly endorse it. One of the difficult things of preparing for this show was that this book, although not, I don't even know how many pages it is, it's 250, something like that.
Something like that.
There's a lot packed in there, and it's extremely informative. And by the way, all the links to Food First and so on will have an association with this show. One of the things that I would like to kind of go back and not review, but to focus on a little bit is, There's been, in fact, you have one of your sections talks about, I forget what the section is actually titled. It's something like land activism, but mm-hmm. It talks about three kinds of things, one of which I have personal experience of, interestingly enough. There's one which is about Seize the Farm, which was a movement in Berkeley to take some UC Berkeley land and put it into food production, and the activism that was involved in that. There's another chapter that is about the National Land for People organization that was formed by George Ballas in the Central Valley of California. And lo, these many years ago, I went on one of George Ballas's tours and knew him and whatnot. So it was actually kind of fun to read about that and to read how that was a model. And then there's a third chapter, which is a much broader discussion of indigenous and African American movements for claiming land rights or land justice, several of those organizations you mentioned. What I wanted to ask you about is the in terms of, again, I'm back to this issue of how we get from justice issues to food production issues and the viability of strategies around what seem to be very local causes, locally focused movements, and broader national movements that create the institutional structure within which a lot of that happens. So, as you mentioned, the Farm Bill is a big deal, and a lot of good could be done with reforms to the Farm Bill, but aren't, because it's a creature of Congress, which is not friendly and is subject to moneyed interests. So in terms of what is most productive of better food, and maybe this calls upon your experience in Cuba, what are the prospects for locally, people being able to take more control and better control over their food supply, the quality of the food and farming generally. And one of the things that I may have missed it, but I didn't hear you mention that comes up is the formation of trusts that can essentially put land, create a commons from which becomes the basis for agriculture or of a new kind of agriculture. So the question is local versus national or structural change in terms of moving this agenda forward.
Yeah, I think that is a really important and really difficult question as well. When we put this book together, I felt that it was really important to avoid making any sort of prescription for the one pathway forward. And I felt that way because there is right now just an enormous plurality in terms of the number of people doing this kind of work and the theories for how it can best be moved forward. And so we decided that right now we might be at a stage when it was best to collectively reflect on all these many different things that are going on. And then hope with the hopes that as this book was released and as we were able to hold community discussions all across the country, that we would be triggering the moment to come together and really form a strategic plan of action for now what comes next. And I think whatever does come next will definitely have to be something that tacks back and forth between local strategies and national policy as well. And at the local level, yes, that was wonderful, Jeffrey, that you mentioned the question of land trusts. That was something that I think of somewhat in relation to these examples like land banking in urban areas. And land trusts are particularly an interesting option as we see so much of the farming population and the rural land-owning population aging right now. And so not to be morbid, but we are looking at a situation where a lot of land will be changing hands very soon or being inherited. And so there are interesting ways in local communities that people can work socially and culturally to build interest in turning land over to these kinds of land trusts once it leaves, you know, the landowner's hands. And that can be a way to ensure that land remains in farm production, that it doesn't go into commercial development or into the hands of real estate speculators or something like that.
Well, one of the things that comes up, and I forget which chapter this is discussed in, but this it's one of the essays talks about one of the things that is preventing greater invasion of speculators into agricultural land is the desire of existing farmers, whatever their practices happen to be, to hold on to that land because farmers, like everybody else, or most other people, their principal wealth is in how they're living in the material form of their wealth. And they're thinking about passing it on and what their descendants will inherit and so on. So there is resistance in that commodity market for land to getting rid of it because people identify that as what they're going to hand on to posterity, which is it slows down that process of the land being chewed up. We'll talk about in a minute. But I wonder, I know that, for instance, well, two things come to mind just specifically locally, that there is provisions in California law to set aside land and have it zoned so that it stays in agricultural production. It can't be used for anything else. But that has had some productive use. And then, but there's also recently, this is a neighbor of mine who has been looking into how to set up land trusts so that the area that we live in is protected. And it looked like, I haven't gotten the details of it yet, but he wasn't able to figure out a way for it to work. So land trusts, it looks like there are local conditions which are favorable and unfavorable. One of the things that is extremely hopeful about your book that was very educational is the number of organizations, particularly African-American organizations, that are working through these issues. So that's kind of my little wrap about land trusts or alternative ways of putting it. We're the source of this brain trust for doing such things would come from a practical standpoint. Is there going to be do you envision a national organization focused on this issue that is a conduit between these organizations, movements, peoples who are engaged in these activities so that they can learn from each other?
Absolutely. I think that would be a wonderful goal and very much to the benefit of this movement. There is an alliance right now called the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance.
Yes.
And they have a working group that's looking at land and resources. And so that has been one potential center for organizing and networking between groups doing this. And there are a lot of really important questions that people in this movement are looking at. So as useful as it would be to have one national organization at the head of this, you know, how do we make sure that person is representative of all the organizations, and how do we make sure that it's an organization that's staffed by women and people of color, and that it doesn't just ultimately come to replicate some of the unfair histories that have happened in this movement and in land allocation at the past. So I think this is very much a goal that a lot of people are working towards. And a lot of people are seeing tremendous potential in uniting the very broad array of people doing this work. I think it's a unique moment at which there's a real reason for, you know, Midwestern farmers growing soy on family land and Black farmers on small plots in the South, and indigenous farmers and indigenous communities working against the pipelines and labor organizations in the West and in the South to come together around this land question, because in many essential ways it's affecting us similarly. And so there's great interest and great motivation to come up with some sort of structure for bringing these people together in this work, but plenty of challenges to work out along the way. But that's certainly a dream that a lot of people are working towards.
You're listening to Your Own Health and Fitness. I'm Jeffrey Fawcett. I'm talking today with Justine Williams about her book, Land Justice, Reimagining Land, Food, and the Commons in the United States. Related, kind of on that theme, this movement, the kind of topics that you cover in this book, land justice, seem to be, to me, to be intimately related to the housing crises that we have.
Because it's
land access. And places like Detroit are really innovating in how to deal with this stuff, with urban agriculture, at the same time as they're dealing with housing crises. And I'd I don't want to get kind of off track here, but is it your perception, or is it a perception in the movement, that we're really dealing with kind of the same problem here, that we're fundamentally talking about this dichotomy, this tension between how land is used and how it is valued, or we live here and we produce things from it? And it's the say we're kind of the problems arise from structural features of what people are struggling with. How you can, who owns it, how you can own it, and how you work your way through a system which is biased against you in important ways. So is there, am I right or close that there's a connection between the struggles for land justice in agriculture as well as land justice in housing?
I think so, absolutely. I think it's the same structural battle for people who are working in fair housing and people who are working in land justice from a more agricultural perspective. I mean, we started out this interview talking about this question of values, the value of land, the value of property. And we're seeing distortions in that, both in housing and in agricultural land. We're seeing the same forces of commercial development and land speculation are driving up prices on both fronts. And there's this sort of form of unfettered capitalism in which speculators have a clear motivation to buy up land, and then either in urban areas or in rural areas, and then take it out of use, is kind of mind-boggling and just incredibly destructive either to achieving fair housing or food justice.
Yeah, that's one of the things I wanted to, again, mention, make sure that we touched on, is how over the last couple of decades, the increasing presence of speculative finance capital in the land economy is creating havoc, because the speculative, land becomes a speculative bubble. Same thing's happening with rental properties, for speaking of housing, that the exchange value of the property is even further removed from its use value, that it has less and less to do with how the land is actually used. And so it works in overdrive against sane practices on the land, sane use of the land. That's kind of my editorial opinion, but do you have any comment?
Absolutely. I absolutely agree on all of that. And there's some very clear examples of the danger of speculation right there in the Bay Area and Oakland. Yeah. Speculation has just been a trend with really tragic results, and the speculation that occurred in the 80s and has really taken land out of use in urban areas and left it vacant, and led to all sorts of social problems, and then driven up all the prices of housing, of commercial property, of everything in the city of Oakland. So it's a very clear example there. And over the course of putting this book together, I had the chance to learn a lot more about how that's a very similar patterns are going on in rural areas as well. And there are certain laws and policies that attempt to limit this, but they're not always effective. But we see increasingly land speculation firms trying to buy up and resell agricultural land and sort of create another artificial financial layer of value on top of that use value. And so that's something very complicated to understand economically. And I think that prevents a lot of us from engaging with it and understanding how to work against it, but is such an important problem.
I say seize it. It's ours. We know what to do with it. We just take it. Well, I guess I shouldn't. Yeah, that wasn't advocacy. That was just... Anyway, speaking of advocacy and activism, one of the things that... Actually, I can't remember where it... I think it was in the afterword that you wrote to the essays.
Uh-huh.
Where you talk about voting with your fork as a form of activism and its inadequacies. So could you talk about that some?
Absolutely. So voting with your fork, I think, is probably something a lot of your listeners have heard about before, and was a, I don't know where the slogan originally came about, but was this idea that was in many ways very empowering and encouraging people to engage in politics through eating and to sway their local economies, maybe even their national economies through the choices that they make. And, you know, there's absolutely nothing wrong with that, and it's very important, and there's a lot that can be done through the decisions that people make about what kinds of food production practices to support and which ones to eschew. But unfortunately, it also relies on having a certain level of resources. It puts a demand on the individual sometimes to sacrifice their own financial resources and convenience to buy food that's often very expensive. And not everyone can afford to do that. And I think it also sometimes can shift the focus a little bit too far afield from the real structural underpinnings of what's wrong in our food system. And so we can do our best to support local farmers and to buy organic dairy, and to not try to buy genetically modified foods. But it's really hard to solve the problem of land justice in that way. It's hard to solve, you know, decades of discrimination against farmers of color that way. And so I think it's important for the food movement we don't have to turn our back on that kind of work, but we have to start thinking more politically and more structurally and much more broadly.
Finally, I want to talk about, or I'd like to ask you about your thoughts on another dimension of food justice that embraces the idea that the land itself has rights, that it deserves value, it has value independent of what human beings feel about it or what human beings want to do with and to it. And there's an organization that we like a lot that's called the Community Environmental Legal Defense Fund, which has been continues to work on focused on the issue of rights of nature and rights of communities. So I believe that's a good strategy for producing a wise use of the land. So the question is there discussion within the land justice movement or land justice activism that you have looked into that kind of contemplates this idea that the land itself has standing?
Yeah, I think that is a really interesting concept and something that I myself would love to know a lot more about. What I am familiar with through some of this land justice work is the way a number of indigenous land justice activists,
yes, right,
both in the U.S. and also other U.S. land activists, for instance, African-American activists who who are studying the African origin of the agricultural practices their communities are involved in, and the African indigenous perspective, to see things along these lines. I think there that must be a lot of connection between the projects you're alluding to and some of these projects, and thinking about the land in terms of, yeah, what can it produce? What is its highest calling, you might say? And I think if we did take that perspective, we would be able perhaps to think in much more just and equitable and certainly more ecologically sustainable ways about how to use land in different contexts and who should use land in different contexts. So I think that's a really interesting frame.
So someone said to me recently with regard to the environmental movement and concern with the ecological effects of human activity and so on, that many people are concerned about, and both from an ethical standpoint and a practical standpoint, of the what our effect is on the living world, whether it's farmland or wilderness or an urban lot. That the question isn't what should we do, but what does the land need? So does that make sense in the context of the work that you've been doing?
I think so, absolutely. I think what is the effect on the living world raises up all the sorts of social questions that we've been asking in land justice. And I think there are so many more sustainable and kind ways to think about relationships between each other and relationships with the earth that could fall into play through this model.
Great. Well, unfortunately, we are entirely out of time. I want to thank you very much, Justine Williams, editor, co-editor of Land Justice. Give us where we can find out more about your work.
Thank you so much, Jeffrey. It's been such a pleasure to talk about these topics with you. And I would invite everyone to visit Food First site and look up our book, Land Justice, and read more about all these amazing projects going on around the country.
And we'll have a link to that on our website in association with our show. Thanks for joining us today. Visit our website, yourownhealthandfitness.org, for information about this show and almost 700 other shows, free access to recordings of all of them, a free newsletter about upcoming shows, and more. To contact us, send email to admin@yourownhealthandfitness.org. Your Own Health and Fitness is produced by Lena Berman and Jeffrey Fawcett. Until next time, take care of yourself.
The resistance continues.
Stardate 2068. Ronald J. Drump has completed his 13th term as cyborg president of planet Earth. Surveying the desolate landscape are a few good apprentices. They are leading the rebel uprising to save planet Earth. Their mission, restore truth before fresh water and clean air are but a distant memory. Captain Catherine has recently returned from her voyage into the future.
It all started at KPFA with a group of apprentices who were trained by the First Voice Apprenticeship Program. Do you have what it takes? Will the truth prevail? You too can be part of the resistance. Check out kpfaapprentice.org to apply, or if you have questions, dial our Rebel headquarters at 510-848-6767, extension 235. The application for this tuition-free program is due on Friday, March 30th at 5 p.m. The resistance needs your voice.
Have you ever argued with your parents, your teachers? Ever question majority opinions? Oppose the status quo? Of course you have. You're listening to KPFA. You're probably proud of being a dissenter. And you're supported in your pride by Charlene Nemeth. She's a professor of psychology at UC Berkeley, and she's going to be presenting her new book, In Defense of Troublemakers, The Power of Dissent in Life and Business, on Thursday, April 12th, 7:30 p.m. at the Hillside Club, 2286 Cedar Street in Berkeley. There is wheelchair access.